Good evening once again, everyone.
Good evening,
fellow.
All right. I hope everyone is fine.
You're fine by His grace.
Great. Thank God. Thank God for everything. Yeah. So, let's just continue. Without further ado. I had to. Okay, so once again, thank you very much for today's session. I know you have prayed already, so I'll just go straight to the point without wasting much time. Yeah, so the quote of the day is that our old history ends with the cross, our new history begins with the resurrection. Our old history ends with the cross, and our new history begins with the resurrection. So let's just go to the review. So today we're talking about the final words of Jesus on the cross, right? Father, forgive them. Today you'll be with me in paradise. The woman, behold your son. We can't touch all of them. In all, I'll be taking your 35 minutes. 35 minutes, that's what I said. So just focus your mind. Let's look at Jesus on the cross. And that is the center of attraction. So we are going back to the cross, the pulpit of the cross. Jesus, in his final days, decided to preach to the world. And that is what we're saying. And the final ways are always very important. Final ways are very, very, very important in the life of everyone. Final ways. It's a time to say goodbye. You know, when someone is dying, his final words, very, very important. And this one says something which is very interesting. He said, I have seen many die surrounded by loved ones, and their ways are, I love you. There are some who could no longer speak, yet their eyes and soft smile left behind that same healing message. I have been in a room where those who where dying made it feel like sacred ground. And so final words, very, very important. When you look at Joshua, his final words, he would tell the Israelites that they should observe the law. They shouldn't. So he gave, you know, very wonderful, you know, message, his final words to the Israelites. You go to Martin Luther King Jr., his final, I have a dream, after that he was shot, you know. So he gave a very wonderful speech, you know, as to whether he knew, it's a different story. Let's look at that of Jesus, the final of Jesus on the cross. And you can go to John chapter 19, verse 16. If you can go to Matthew chapter 27, they are there. You can have access to that after that. Jesus on the cross and then giving a final message. You can see people, different kind of people there. And then what happened on that Golgotha wasn't easy. It was an eyesore. And so these people, even when they were going, in Luke chapter 24, or a mouse walk, when they were going back, they were so demoralized, you know, they were so frustrated that they were talking about it. This guy we thought would come and save us, and then there he died. So he had to even come to their rescue by explaining certain things to them, because it was not easy. It was not an easy scene, you know. And then there, among the congregants, you see different people. You go to Matthew chapter 27 up to chapter 28. You talk about the mother of Jesus, their beloved apostles, their loved ones, Mary Magdalene, soldiers, chief priests, teachers of the law, elders, robbers, those who passing by, insulted him, onlookers. They stood there looking at it. So different people were there to listen to the final words of Jesus, which was not easy. And this is what I have for you. It's a quote. So that on the pulpit of the cross, Christ summarized his teaching to the world. There he summarized his teachings to the world. In the pulpit, he summarized his teaching to the world. You know, it's never a sermon like the seven last words of Jesus. There's never been a sermon like that. And you could hear, you see, it's just summarized everything. What is the first word? Father, forgive them. They know not what they are doing. Jesus said this. The first word of Jesus, you know, and it's just interesting. Forgive who? Forgive them, their enemy. His enemies, those who hurt him, those who tried him, those who blackmailed him, those who betrayed him, those who crucified him, they were all there. Those people saying all kind of words, passing, those who were passing by, those who were standing there. Jesus just said that, forgive them. And this man says something, he's a philosopher, you know, Seneca. You know, Seneca said that those who are crucified curse the day of their birth, but Jesus didn't curse the day of his birth. Jesus rather, he was even asking for forgiveness for those who crucified him, his enemies. Jesus said so. And then also there is another Jewish historian, Josephus, who say that Romans will never allow a fellow Roman to be crucified because it's an eyesore. It's actually an eyesore. And that is the time when people curse those who are actually hurting them. But Jesus didn't do that. The question for you is that what do you, would you say, or sometime, what do you say when someone causes you a pain? What do you say to the person? It hits you hard. We curse them. We don't bless them. We don't ask for forgiveness for them. We curse them. Those who don't believe in you, those who don't believe in you, those who say all kind of things, you know, what do you say to them? Those who kind of spit on you, those who mock at you, what do you do? You're executioners. Do you ask for forgiveness for them? I don't think so. You curse them rather. Is that not it? Jesus didn't change his gospel on the cross. Jesus did not change his gospel, you know, when in pain. He maintained his position, and because this is what he told them. He said, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who, you know, persecute. He said all these things to his people, and he didn't change a word on the cross. He maintained that position. He didn't change his teaching that I am in pain. So do you change your position when you are in pain or when someone is, you know, causing you pain? Sometimes we change our positions. You know, we change our position, but Jesus did not change his position. And today, your brother Jesus is giving you a message. And the message Jesus is giving you is that in pain, in difficulty, say, pray for pardon and forgiveness. That is what your brother is telling you today. Pray for forgiveness for those who hurt you. And to forgive is the highest and most beautiful form of love. In return, you will receive untold a peace and a happiness, says that man. And this is what Jesus is telling you today. You have to learn from Jesus today. He is telling you that you should forgive and forget. Who takes the first step? Who asks? When someone sins against me, when someone hurts me, is it the person who has to come? Jesus, the forgiving victim. Jesus took the first step. You know, they hurt him. He took the first step. Because you ask yourself, if you go back to Matthew chapter 8, verse 15 to 20, Jesus instructed his people, you know, his apostles, his disciples, it is here. But then it's too long here. He said, if your brother sins against you, blah, 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 it's too long, but it's summarized here. Deal with him, deal with it privately. If unsuccessful, involve others. And then the third one, he said, if first two steps don't succeed, involve the church. And then after that, Jesus will say that leave the person as a pagan. He said that. And so you take the first step. You don't wait for the person to come to you and say that this person hurt me, so I have to wait for him to come and apologize. No. Look at even when we were looking at the prodigal son, it was the father who took the initiative. When he saw the son coming, he ran towards him and created that platform for the son to apologize. You know, he created the platform, the parable of the lost son or the merciful father. He created that. And if you look at the lost sheep, the shepherd decided to go in, to go and look for the lost sheep, you see? So, and then when he found the lost sheep, he was very happy. And so you see, so when it comes to forgiveness, you take the first step. The victim takes the first step. And when it comes to the first, you know, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. There on the cross, you could see Jesus forgiving, taking the initiative to forgive. And that is the Christian teaching of forgiveness. You, the victim, take the first initiative, the first step. And Jesus did exactly that and asked for forgiveness for those persecuting him. And there on the cross, actions speak louder than words. He didn't just teach. Jesus showed that in his life. That was the message he was giving to those present there. Actions speak louder than words. next time someone tries to convince you that they care, look at what they do, not what they say. Sometimes we look at people, what they say, we don't look at what they do. And I have a message for you. Sometimes those who hurt you don't actually know what they are doing. And I have a message here. Sometimes when you are rejected by people, don't think it is because you are not good enough. It might be a clear sign of projection of their own fears and insecurities. Love yourself and be positive in life. And that is a message you guys see. Sometimes people hurt you, it's their past. Sometimes you need to understand their past, their background, to be able to understand. And they don't even know that. Some do not even know that they are even hurting you. You know, look at the soldiers. They were just carrying out duty. You know, frustrated people, broken within, try to project their anger on Jesus. Just try to carry out a command. The second words of Jesus, this day you will be with me in paradise. Very shocking. Jesus told the thief, and we profess this thing. We say, he will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom have no end. And there on the cross, you could see a judge on the cross. Two divisions of humanity. This one, the two. Jesus judging between them. And then, very interesting. And when you look at the cross, Jesus naked on the cross without anything. Just on the cross, you could see decision making. They took off his garment and shed with him. And that's what happens in judgment, where they're going to be decision making. You could see that clearly on the cross when they cast lost. You know, I don't want to go into the nitty-gritty of that. And then you see the final judgment where God will be coming to judge the living and the dead. And so you see, you know, when we come into the end of the liturgical year, that is the reading we normally take. You know, end of liturgical year, where we're celebrating Christ the King, Christ on the cross. You know, Christ the King, we normally take this reading where you look at, where you look at the goats and the sheep. There on the cross, you could see judgment on the cross. And you could see Matthew chapter 25, verse 31 to 48, the goats and the sheep on the cross down there. What about the thieves? So just take two. So go to Luke chapter 23, verse 32 to 34. Two other men, both criminals, were led out with him. They were crucified. And then the first criminal says something. You know, two, Jesus be in the middle. One of the criminals who were hung blasphemed him, saying, if you are the Christ, save yourself and save us. Luke chapter 23, verse 39. And then the second criminal who said that, and we indeed justly, you know, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. He said that. And then he told Jesus, then he said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. There, in between, you could say, you could see, take me up and then take me down. See the criminal, one like the goat, the other like the sheep. You could see there, you could see two of them. Yeah, thank you. And so we could see that just there. And then the second criminal, then he said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus told him, so. The question, we have a lot of questions here. A dying man asks a dying man for eternal life. What did he see in Jesus? Maybe the question we should be asking now. What did he see in Jesus on the cross that led to his conversion and a deep proclamation of faith? What did he see? Jesus was not even talking as much. The priestly prayer of pardon and forgiveness, even in pain. Then the calmness. Jesus was calm, though in pain. He didn't curse them. The love he showed, you know, down there, Jesus was saying, forgive them. That he could connect with Jesus in that level. And then the non-verbal teaching on the cross, even in the pain, even down there, Jesus was teaching, was communicating, you know, heart to heart. He could connect with Jesus, and that alone convey the message. And then he decided to come back. And there you could see the teaching of Jesus out there. Jesus taught about the parable of the lost sheep. And you could see the lost sheep was able to listen to the master's heart beat, even when he was silent. And he cried out for help, because a sheep, a lost sheep, supposed to cry out when the master calls. They were able to communicate. And then there, he was found just on the cross. You can see the playback of the replay of all that Jesus did just on the cross. And Jesus answered them, you see, a sinner, I came not to call the righteous. There, the message of Jesus playing all over again. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Just down there. And then the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life. And that is the thief on the cross. That thief on the cross was giving life. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. You see a whole lot of, and there, to our surprise, when Jesus gave up his life, who escorted him to his father's house? No other person. Riding in front of Jesus was a sinner, not a saint. A sinner changed to a saint. So interesting, when Jesus entered the Father's kingdom, it was that sinner who converted on the cross. Very interesting. The Lord, remember me when you come to me. He remembered. One thing you should know, that good people don't go to heaven. Forgiving sinners do, because sometimes we claim that we are better than others. And then, but it's here, Romans chapter 3, verse 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It is there. And this is the picture you could see. Man, Jesus, God. This is the separation before Jesus came. The man there, God created, this gap was created by who? The first, the four. And then the four were sucked into the desert, restless soul in the desert, wandering, and were cursed. And there, God's rescue mission sent the Son. He sent a prophet upon prophet, the priest as seed, and then he sent the Son. And then he asked, "Whom shall I send?" I heard a voice, and he said, "I am here, send me." Isaiah chapter 6. And then Jesus came into, though he was in the form of God, Jesus did not count equality of with God a thing to be grasped. So this kenosis, and he came into the picture, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And then Jesus decided to go back into the desert where we were sucked into, where we were wandering. Desert compared to a wandering place, a place of discomfort. That was the state of man. And God sent the Son, decided to go to the desert, confronted the Satan who convinced Adam in the form of a snake. Very tricky, canny. When we're talking about snake, we're not talking about a real snake. You know, we're talking about how snake wise. Jesus who could use this one here. Behold, I send you as sheep. Therefore, be wise as serpent. Very canny, wise in the desert, try to convince Jesus. Still, Satan jumped from the top, changed this into the, but Jesus overcame him, defeated him in the desert. And then there was a rejoicing in heaven after he defeated him. Then he started his ministry. And then he called his apostles. He calls others to join in the ministry. People followed. Then later on, associated himself with sinners. He was killed. And then he decided to bridge that gap. You can read here, the saving through grace, Romans chapter 3, verse 21. And then after everything, he says, the sixth word, it is finished. And the question, why it is finished? Because he has accomplished the mission. Jesus paid it in full. Paid in full. He has rescued us. What is the proof? The proof is that he decided to see on the cross, the final day, he has to show the Father that I have done the work. And on the cross, and you could see the rider, the escort, the one who escorted Jesus to the Father's house. The proof, it showed him that now I've decided to bridge the gap. And so this criminal, and then took him, the criminal represent all of us, and then back, he took us back with himself to God as a proof, you know, and then bridging the gap. All have sinned and fallen short. Now he bridges this gap between God and man. And that is it. And that is why when he died, they said, and the curtain of the temple was torn into two. Jesus called out the loud voice, "Father, with your hands I command." And then it was torn. And this is the temple. It's covered here. It's covered. And then you will see open the Ark of the Covenant, the presence of God open to all, torn into two. Then Jesus opened the gates to the Father's house for all of us. Now we can pray. We become, through baptism, you become the sons and daughters of God. a question we should be reflecting on. Because I can't go into all the nitty-gritty, as I said, all the sayings of Jesus today, because they are all kind of whole theology, which we can't finish today. So maybe another day, it will be available next week, we'll finish up. Question for you is, how do you evangelize even in challenging time? How do we? Are you ready to take the first step in the process of forgiveness? Are we ready? When someone hurts you, are you ready to say that, no, I have to take the first step like Jesus did? Ask yourself, you walk your talk, or you change your principle depending on the situation. Some of us, we do that. We look at faith and we change our principles. When we are Christians, we change like Camelo. Some of us, we do that. How do you react to those hurting you? What did Jesus do? He prayed for them. Do you pray for them? Identify yourself in one of the characters, you know, before Jesus on the cross. Where do you belong? The chief priest? The soldiers? Those who stand by? Where do you belong? Identify yourself in one of the characters as we stand before the cross and contemplate. What is your first reaction to those you do not know? Those you do not know, how do you treat them? Harsh, like the one at the left? You save others, save yourself and save us too. How is that how you react? Or you give people chance, considerate. At the repentant chief, at the soldiers before the cross, do you just act based on single story coming from a friend? Some of us, once it's coming from our friends, we judge people. Or loved one, we judge them. Or you try always to find out the other side of the story. Some of us, that's what we do. Once we hear one side of the story, we conclude. Do you allow yourself to be influenced in terms of character assassination? You know, do you allow yourself to be influenced, to be used as a tool to destroy others? Do you stand unconcerned at work while a just man or a woman is punished for an unjust cause or reason? Some of us, we stand there, we know the truth that this person is suffering not because of what he has done. Some people were standing there unconcerned. They could do something, you know. They were having power to say no, but they stood there. That's why we say something for what I have done and what I failed to do. It's a sin. Like the chief priests, teachers, Pharisees, etc. Do you blackmail or take part in blackmailing someone because of envy? That's all we could see. Because of envy, they decided to pursue their case and kill him and make sure that they saw him crucified. Reminder for you, don't judge people based on a single story you have heard about them. Because a single story is not just untrue or an incomplete. It creates stereotypes and robs people of their dignity. Give people chance. Listen to other side of stories before you judge people like Pilate. You know, look at other side. Don't multiply words when you are angry. Jesus was quiet when they were mocking them. Sometimes the best thing said when you don't exchange words. You just exchange space. Please. That is what we're supposed to do. And remember also, it's a reminder, Jesus did not just die on the cross. He died for you, all of us. That is what we should be mindful of. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Father. Thank you so much. If there are no more questions, please can you give us the final, the closing prayer and the blessing.
In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. Father of mercy, we can all say it, like the prodigal son, I return to you and say, I have sinned against you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your child. Christ Jesus, Savior of the world, I pray with a repentant thief to whom you promised a paradise. Lord, remember me in your kingdom. Holy Spirit, fountain of love, I call on you with trust. Purify my heart and help me to walk as a child of the light. Amen. The Lord be with you, and may the blessings of the Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you now and forever. Amen.
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 Amen.